Thank you. Well, I'm so happy to have you here, Subhuti. Not just because we're here at Toluca Buddhist Center. And so I'm delighted actually to receive everyone here, whoever is around in whichever time zone. But especially having Subhuti here, I'm really, really happy to have you here. So welcome.
Thank you very much. I'm absolutely delighted to be here in Mexico in general, but particularly in Toluca, our newest center.
Yes, this is our newest center in Mexico.
Yeah.
We have been open for about 2 years now. And so we're here to talk about your impression on Latin America, especially Mexico, in Triratna, the Sangha. So, yeah, I also believe that this is a very important conversation to have. So, yeah, would you like to say something about your general impression?
Well, first of all, I should say that, of course, I'm in Mexico. I've not been to the rest of Latin America yet, but I'm coming. just from a very personal point of view, I've been welcomed so wholeheartedly. It's been a great, great delight to me. It's the sort of welcome that I'm a bit familiar with from India, but I'm afraid in Europe we're not quite as good at that. But I've been treated so well here, I felt very happy and felt I'd made a lot of new friends. So that's a very personal take on it, and I'm slowly adapting to Mexican food. Of course, I've had Mexican food before, but not Mexican food. It all suits me so well. So one of the things that I can say is that it reminds me a lot of India. I say it's India with the volume turned down. It's about 10% of the volume of India, both literally. There is quite a lot of noise here, but India is 10 times as much. Yes, you have chili in everything. They have even more chili. People are very spontaneous and very warm and friendly. But here, I think you equal them. It's not 10%. So I feel very, very much at home. It's very familiar to me. And oddly, it's also familiar to me because in certain ways, it's not that far from Europe. And so it works in many ways at a functional level, rather like Europe does. So both sides of my life have come together in Mexico. So very, very happy and impressed, and want to thank everybody from Mexico who's happens to be listening for giving me such a warm welcome and looking after me so well. I don't know that in a way I've been in Mexico. I've been in the land of Triratna in Mexico. One day I hope I'll be let loose on Mexico itself. Yes, a warm, warm, hearty thanks for the way you've all treated me. A very interesting culture to me in Mexico, insofar as I'm able to tell. I've only been here for 3.5 weeks, so I must be careful not to overgeneralize from that experience. But the impression I get is of a very interesting mixture of influence coming from Europe via Spain, especially, but not only Spain, anciently, and then continuously over the centuries. And the indigenous influence, which is much nearer the surface than I'd expected. I thought it was going to be a matter of looking at pyramids and dreaming of the past, as it were. But no, it's very, very close under the surface. Not even under the surface. It's very, very evident in the imagination of people. I've been interested, sort of the mestizado character of people. There's a mixture of the two different, as it were, racial influences to varying degrees, which makes for a quite different mood. I suspect there's nowhere quite like Mexico. Nowhere I've been that's quite like Mexico, although India is a little bit like Mexico. What I find particularly interesting and impressive is this sense of the rich imaginative world coming from the, let's call it, indigenous background, which everybody, no matter what their particular genetic makeup, feels. Everybody relates very strongly to the imaginative world of the Nahua and the Maya and so forth. It's very, very evident in people's imaginations. And my general impression is that in quite a contrast with Europe and perhaps North America, which I don't know so well anymore, the two sides of the brain, if you like to use that metaphor, are much more in dialogue. I think that certainly in Britain, sorry, my British compatriots, I think we're developing an increasingly alienated culture. And I think it was a sort of strong need for us to get back. In fact, Bante said that if we wanted really to develop a Buddhist culture, we needed to recontact our pagan roots. But it's very difficult because they're so far away in Europe, and perhaps even further away in North America. Although, please, I shouldn't speak about what I don't know. But certainly in England, I live in Wales, actually, and it's a little bit closer there, a little bit more evident there. But in England, it's a long way away. Stonehenge is there, but we don't have it so much as part of our immediate imaginative world. But here, my sense is that this extraordinary union of the Spanish with the indigenous people has created a unique consciousness. Yes, I think that's what I'm talking about, was a Mexican consciousness. It's not perfect. Don't get me wrong there. It's not perfect. Maybe on my next visit, I'll give you a list of all of my complaints. But but this sense that there's less of a sort of disconnection between the conscious and the unconscious. So maybe I should sort of stop there, and you might have some more provocative questions to ask me. But
sure.
But that's something that I find deeply appealing. And I found giving a talk in Mexico is much more like giving a talk in India. The audience is wide open, and very alive, and very, very responsive. And I can talk very personally. I don't have to watch what I'm saying. People are not trying to sort of catch me out, which you often feel with an audience in Britain. Sorry, British, I'll be back soon, don't worry. It's a skepticism and a sort of, wait a minute. But in Mexico, people seem much more sort of immediately open. There's more I can say about that, but I should let you speak a bit.
I was thinking from what you're saying, you have like this vision or your impression of how Mexican culture in general is. Mm-hmm. So how, what's the importance on that directly to the Sangha?
Yes.
Or for Buddhism
in
Mexico?
Yeah. Yes, very, very important question. I think that we respond to the Dhamma not from our heads.
Yeah.
In a way, we don't even respond from our hearts. We respond from something deeper, something that's beyond head and heart, more, if I might put it this way, intuition, but I mean a deeper intuition. In other words, faith, Shraddha. And we all know Shraddha does not mean the same as it does in the Christian context and so forth. I think that I don't have to put in the footnotes there. But the problem with our modern situation is that we're generally coming to Buddhism, having sort of left behind our old religion. and often rejected features of you know, for most of us, Christianity, of course, in India, is Hinduism. And in the course of doing that, there's a disconnection from our own sort of roots, our own imaginative roots. And so faith is compromised in a way. We have to struggle to release it. But what I sense in Mexico is much easier for people to respond wholeheartedly with faith. Probably could do with a little bit more thought. I said I wasn't going to make any critical comment. I don't want everybody to think that I think this is perfect. It's not blind faith, though. It's a wholehearted response. And I especially experience that in relation to Bhante. Because as we all know, that's a tricky question, especially in the Anglo-Saxon world, for various cultural reasons and so on and so forth. I just haven't encountered that at all here. And yet people know all the secrets. They're not ignorant or foolish or blind in that way. It's just that they sense something in Bhante that is beyond all that. I've been amazed at the number of dreams people have told me where Bhante has appeared to them, and I can recognize Bhante in the dreams they've told me, even though they've never met him. So there's a very, very uncomplicated, but not unsophisticated response, if you see what I mean. First of all, I think one has to have that ability to respond alive if one is really to take to the Dharma. And my worry about Western Buddhism, especially in the Anglo-Saxon countries, is increasingly cerebral. And so insight is increasingly conceived in cerebral terms out there. And actually, I think it's much more to do with faith. Even the Buddha describes, when he's asked to describe a stream entrant, he talks about it as a serene faith in the Buddha, Dhamma, and Sangha. Actually, in Iti Biso Bhagava, in the Triratna Vandana, each of the Vandanas. A serene faith, that is what characterizes a stream entrant. This wholehearted response from something deep within one that is beyond, but includes both head and heart, if you like, emotion and reason. So I think that there's something about the culture of Mexico, and quizás, wait a minute, what's the English word? Perhaps, probably. Probably for the rest of Latin America in different ways. For whatever reason, I'm not sure. But I think it means that there's an unusually fertile ground for us here in Mexico. I believe we ought to be investing hugely money, resources, human beings, etc. in Mexico, because take up another thing, I think it's the key to our evolution in Latin America in general, perhaps in the whole of America.
Good. So I was thinking about, this brings me back to the potential maybe that you can see in Latin America. And I'm thinking also about young people coming, which is something that it's important for us as an order right now, worldwide.
Yes, indeed.
So I was thinking, for example, when I was young and I was with Sangadara and Richiro Mati, and I remember...
Well, that was yesterday, wasn't it?
Okay, when I was much younger. I'm not that young anymore.
No, I'm afraid not.
But, I mean, there was this sense of something bigger than ourselves that we were looking for, but it was hard for us to find out what it was. We used to, as a funny anecdote, we used to call each other the cookie seekers, if that makes any sense. It doesn't have to make sense. Because we were not sure of what the cookie meant. The cookie, I guess now I can put it in terms of the transcendental, something bigger than yourself. So we were just looking for that cookie to, and the Dharma became that cookie. But what I can recognize is that there was this openness to find something more important in life.
Yes, yes.
So even a way of living that was different from what we were presented.
Yes.
Just go and work and, the traditional model.
Mm-hmm.
So I wonder which is your impression of this potential for young people in Mexico?
Yeah. Well, I've been educated a bit by my youngish friends in Mexico, including yourself, that young people in Mexico face quite a bit of nihilism, a sense that there is nothing higher, nothing beyond. And we had an interesting conversation about fantasy novels,
which
always fascinates me. Why? Often it's actually in Europe too, but I ask people what they're reading. I always ask what people are reading, and they say fantasy novels. So we explored together what that was about, which I found extremely interesting. And you thought it was because in fantasy novels there is a sense of some heroic, some higher, some ideal, however represented, maybe not even particularly artistically well presented, but nonetheless there's a sense of something more. Maybe that's the cookie that people are looking for. So yes, but at the same time, I think even though there's nihilism, because the Catholic Church is measurably losing members day by day throughout Latin America. I saw a very interesting article about this in The Economist recently, which argued that the Catholic Church was in rapid retreat. There's somewhat of an increase in the Protestant churches, and especially evangelical churches. It doesn't match the fall in the Catholic Church. This is particularly marked amongst young people. And of course, the Catholic Church, whatever one wants to say about it, does still contain some sense of something higher. However, we might find it difficult to accept that language and so forth, but there's a sense of something beyond the ordinary, everyday business. But as that collapses for people, and they no longer can take the cookie at the mass, what are they left with? So my sense is that we have an unusual opportunity in Latin America because of that fact. And so that will be particularly true with young people, because their flight from the traditional church is probably more drastic than the older generations. And so we need to act fast, brothers and sisters, really fast. We've no time to waste, because it will just pass into the sort of cynical nihilism that is prevalent in my country. It's very difficult to work with beyond a certain point. It's interesting, the movement started in Britain in the 1960s. When we were definitely looking for the cookie, we were feeling that movement from the old world, which we could no longer believe in, we still believed there was something. And then there was Bante, speaking our language, entering our world. He's gotten in a lot of trouble for it, but he really did. That's what happened. He just explored. And as a result of that, so many of the early order members, of the senior cadre of order members, we were older than you. Well, you were 17, weren't you, when you came
on? Yeah, we were.
Yeah. But we were, I think I was 19 when I first came on, very old by that time. We just, the Dharma was kind of the answer to our quest.
Yes.
So I suspect there's, obviously in a very different cultural context, there's something similar going on. And Bante said that, he quotes Shakespeare, there's a tide in the affairs of men that taken at the flood leads on to fortune. So at a tide, the current is moving in a certain direction. If you take it when it's, moving in that way, it goes to fortune. If you wait, it goes the other way. And it's gone the other way in Britain. It's more of a struggle now. So I think you've got I'll give you 20 years.
Good.
Yeah.
Let's work hard.
Yes. Yeah. But I think it's very pertinent. I was going to ask you sort of a little bit more about the cookie factor, which brought you along. What how did that manifest, if you see what I mean? How did you think? Mm. What brought you to the Buddhist center?
Yeah, I remember that I had this feeling of even loss.
Oh.
Especially because, yeah, we, many young people, yeah, we don't feel really connected to Catholicism.
Oh.
But yeah, you still feel that there's something deeper that you want to connect with, but you just don't know what is that, mm-hmm. where to go. Mm-hmm. So what personally, what I was feeling was a sense of loss, a sense of, mm-hmm. yeah. I don't know what to do. Mm-hmm. And there was a lot of dukkha. A lot of pain there. It's very painful to have this sense, this intuition mm-hmm. that there is something bigger, but you just mm-hmm. don't know what that is. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I remember that it was just by chance that I went to a retreat. Actually, it was
by chance.
Well,
there must be some.
Of course.
Everything arises in dependence on conditions.
That's so true. But I mean, that's how it felt.
Yeah,
like, it could have been anything.
I see. I see.
And I was, so by that time, I was 15. And I was like, oh, let's see what these Buddhists think. I remember myself thinking like that.
Yeah.
And I went to the retreat. And I had this immediate sense, really, mm-hmm. that feeling of loss was starting to change. Uh-huh. It was immediate. Yeah. It really was, especially when I connected with the idea of ethics.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I think that there was this amazing new world.
Mm-hmm.
And I loved the way you said quest.
Mm-hmm.
That word really speaks to me, quest. Because I was feeling that I wanted to go to a quest, and but I didn't know where to. So there was like the path or something, and I even if I was feeling funny about the puja, I was connecting with the puja. I was, so I never looked back. You know, it was like this is it.
Yeah,
and there was then a feeling of finding myself. So I reconnected with Sanghadhara, just then. And we realized that we were both going to the Buddhist center.
So you were schoolmates, were you?
We were.
With Ramati, yeah.
We met with Ramati a little bit later.
Okay.
But we were in the same school. And we realized that we were going to the Buddhist center, Mexico Buddhist center. Mm-hmm.
From Toluca.
Pretty much at the same time from Toluca, but not to the same activities.
Okay.
So it was interesting, and then we reconnected, and our friendship started again from the Dharma, which is what makes us being such good friends.
Yeah.
We're brothers.
Yeah, yeah.
We're siblings.
Yeah.
But then we were talking about us wanting to connect with something deeper, and there's where we started calling that thing the cookie. And then of course we realized that it was the transcendental, and it was enlightening as an ideal. But yeah, I can see how that feeling of loss started to disappear more and more, because we together felt that we found our place. So I think that's an experience that many young people connect to.
That's what I was going to ask you. Do you think your experience is generalizable? Do you think that others will feel the same sort of thing?
Yeah.
Are you connecting with them?
I'm trying to. Yeah. I think I can do more, and I'm going to try to do more.
I'm sure you are.
But yeah, I do believe that we are trying to connect from there.
So that's one of the most important things,
yes,
that we do that. Otherwise, we're a dying breed.
Yes.
So
what do you imagine that's going to happen in Mexico or Latin America in the future? What's your projection?
Well, of course, that the Dharma is going to have a profound influence on the whole of Mexican society, and thereby probably on the whole of Latin America. That's my very rash prediction. I'm quite safe because I I'm going away soon. But at the order retreat, I was telling people that you must think about there being 2,000 order members in Mexico, and that's just a little fraction of what there will be. But we need to open our imaginations to what will be if you just keep going as you are doing now. 2,000 is not that difficult. So yes, I imagine that Mexico will have a very live Sangha, which will cover most of the major cities. I really hope that we'll connect much more with not just the economically wealthy. I hope that we'll be connecting even with indigenous people, and that the Dhamma will influence much more broadly. And I don't see why that shouldn't happen with the sort of spirit that there is in the order and movement at the moment. If you can keep that going, and I don't see why you shouldn't. I think there's the energy and the liveliness and the sense of sangha to connect more and more people. So I see that happening. I think that what's really necessary for that to happen is institutions that enable greater depth.
Yeah.
We do have access to a very, very pleasant, very good retreat center, Chintamani, which Sarojyoti and Mokshasi founded. But we need a place where people can live all the time as a community, where people can stay for longer periods of time. All the places we use for retreats are quite expensive, and it's not easy. And they're about the same cost as retreats in Britain. And the income of the people's income is much smaller. So a weekend retreat can be a fair proportion of people's salary, monthly salary. So obviously we need to try to, I think in the next phase, make the our facilities much more economically accessible.
Yeah.
To give opportunities for people to spend longer periods of time in intensive practice. I mean, like you yourself spent time at on the Dharma Life course at Ajitana. You were ordained at Akashavana.
No,
you were ordained in Mexico.
Yes.
Yeah, that's very important. But quite a lot of order members have spent time on wind tours, Little City and others. We'll make a long list. Quite a lot of gone to Adishtana for the Dharma Life course, both the men's and the women's. Quite a lot of been ordained at Kuhiloka or Akashavana. And I think that has been a very important experience for people, because those facilities, those institutions are quite mature, and they're sort of long-term, they're enduring.
Mm.
But you can't keep sending people across the Atlantic.
Yeah.
It's expensive. And anyway, like some people can't learn Spanish, learn English,
yes,
a funny old language. Some people can't learn it. You don't have that chip. And that's not fair, if you see what I mean, and it's not appropriate.
Yes.
And especially if we're going to get to other economic strata.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's very important that we make provisions here for that kind of intensity and depth. You'll have to work out what that means. But I think it's very, very important that in the next few years, it's possible to do a complete training in which you get that experience of the culture of the Sangha. It's very difficult when you're just going to a center. You get a lot from that, and that you're living basically at home. It's fine. You can practice the Dharma fully in that way. But we really need situations where people are experiencing the mature practice of the Dhamma in an institutional context, in other words, a community, which is what you experience when you go to Bangaloka or Triratna or Kashavana, etc. You experience that, and it is something more than just individuals practice. It's something that emerges collectively. So I think that that's, to me, the next phase. And I think if you develop that, then Mexico can become a hub for people from elsewhere in Latin America who can come and train here, like some of our friends are already doing. And we've got an Argentinian in the audience here. Argentina in the audience here. I don't know whether that was a proper Argentinian accent, but it'll do. You know, the people need that experience and somewhere to train, and particularly young people. We need to give somewhere for young people to go much deeper. So this is your responsibility, Bodhikámala. I'm sure you're up for it. So, but I think if you can do that, then I'm sure that Mexico is a very good base for everywhere in Latin America. Eventually, they all need their own such institutions. But Mexico is relatively politically stable. Mm-hmm. It's not had a military coup for 100 years or whatever. It's got a relatively good economy. It's a very free society. You know, for instance, it seems to be, you know, for instance, for gay people, it, in the cities at least, is not that hard from what I've seen. Not that I've been looking around in that way, but from what my friends tell me. And I believe that there's not the same sort of complexities around sexuality that there are often in the Anglo-Saxon world. So it's very free. You can say what you like. So that is a tremendous opportunity, because it's not like that everywhere else in Latin America. There are much bigger economic problems, there are much bigger political instability, and the Catholic Church still has quite a stranglehold in some countries. I think Mexico is in a unique position. This is my 3 weeks judgment.
Well, you have been speaking with many of us for a long time, so. So I was thinking that, yes, something that the order can offer, especially for young people, is like a vision of a life, a full life. It's not just, as you were saying, it's not just, I go to the center and I do this, and then I go back to my job. Yeah. Like, you can really live and experience a full Dharma life. And I think that is our responsibility to show that to the young people, that you can have a life like Bodhikámala lives, or someone else, and that's something that it's possible to do. And so what you were saying brings me to the question that, which challenges you see for us ahead?
Well, I think there's first of all clearly an economic one. If you are to create circumstances for young people, especially to be able to live the life, you need to have means of economic support. Which has been, we were very fortunate at the time the movement started. We could easily get, the government supported us to practice the Dhamma. It didn't know it was doing that, but it did. You know, for instance, we had access to houses that were empty, waiting redevelopment. And according to a law of the 14th century, if you got into such a house, you could live there free until they threw you out. So our movement started on that basis, on the basis of a very free society, because it was the 1960s, you know, Jagger and all that, and Jimi Hendrix particularly. But anyway, we won't go there. Sex, drugs, and rock and roll. This extraordinary freedom that we had at that time to develop things, economic freedom. We could live so cheaply. And as I say, we could easily get support from the government. So that created the basis for our movement. So you need to find some substitution for that, some way of putting economic resources to support people to train and to live the life, as I put it. Bhante spoke of us needing to create a Buddhist world, because it's only in that world that you can be completely a Buddhist. Otherwise, you have to be on guard, you have to explain yourself, you have to keep certain things to yourself. But you need a world in which you just be completely relaxed and free to be a Buddhist. So we need to create that sort of world, and it has an economic factor to it. Mm. And young people need to think about their futures. I imagine that there's, you know, how are you going to earn your living? Mm. Those sort of factors I think you have to deal with. I think that's a major one, the economic factors. Mm. There are others. What were they? No, I did have them in my mind. They'll come to me in a minute. But that I think is the major one, the economic issue. And of course, enough of you who are already involved need to commit yourselves to creating that and bringing it about, which means a certain degree of self-sacrifice.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Stepping aside from the rat race, as we say, and building something that will be a basis for people in the future. They'll have that experience. Whatever they do afterwards, they will have that unforgettable experience. I'm sure you remember that from the Dharma Life course.
Mm-hmm.
It probably still influences you, the yes. experience that you had there.
Yeah.
So maybe that'll do for now. There's another point that I want to make, but I'll come back to it. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mm. Mm.
So what would you suggest, or what would be an advice that you could give us as a movement, as the order here in Mexico?
I think the first thing is be immensely proud of what you've achieved. Immensely proud. Yeah. I rejoice over and over again in the merits of Upekshamati, who's one in, I was going to say a million, but that's far too small a number. A very, very unusual man. I'm proud to say I ordained him. And I'm even more proud to say that just 3 or 4 months after he was ordained, he came to me saying, what do you think I should do next? And I said, go back to Mexico. Everybody else was telling him, don't go, you're too junior. But thank goodness he did. So I rejoice again and again in his merits. And then, of course, all the other Mexicans who've contributed, and people from Britain, Spain, Ptolemy, Paramagitta, Mokshananda, and of course, Nagapriya. We must mention Nagapriya. And others, I'm not, Sabamati, Paramabandhu now, Sadokara, you know, so many people from Europe have contributed. I think you're actually getting to be independent now.
Mm.
I don't think you need that. And actually, I think people from Europe and maybe North America too could do with some training here, because they'll get an experience of a different consciousness, a consciousness in which faith and reason are not so alienated.
Mm.
And the sort of doubts and suspicions that are endemic are not so present.
Mm.
So yes, first of all, be really proud of what you have.
Mm-hmm.
And I hope that part of the reason I think Chandradasa suggested I did something that I wanted especially to have an interview with you, or just conversation with you, was to boast about Mexico.
Mm-hmm.
It's more difficult for you to boast. I can boast. I think that there's people outside Mexico in our movement do not realize what riches there are here. And I'm not just saying that because I want my dinner. I'm going on Thursday, so I haven't got anything to lose at this point. But yes, I seriously think that there's something very special for our movement in Mexico, something very pure. It's Triratna as Bhante intended it, unadulterated. I recognize it so clearly, and I know how proud Bhante was of the movement in Mexico. So please, you be proud. Don't think that it's better everywhere else. If you're tempted to do that, the Indians need to be careful of this too. But actually, Mexico has a lot to teach the rest of the movement. So please be very, very proud of what you do. So that's the first thing. Yeah. Then I think cultivate these deep institutions. Of course, individually, you need to cultivate depth.
Yeah.
But one's own development isn't just about one's own development. One's own development is about sangha, friendship. It's about deep connections on the basis of the Dhamma. And so, yes, it's a very nice atmosphere here, very friendly. I've been on two retreats. I've been on an order retreat for a week and a very, very good coordination process retreat for 3 days. And there's a wonderful atmosphere, very, very free, open, positive. I'm not just saying it positive. but it's not enough. There needs to be a shared lived Dhamma life somewhere in it, which everybody can then benefit from. So if you have got, for instance, you've got a job, you've got a family, you can have recourse to situations where others are have the advantage of living much more fully in the sense of overtly a shared Buddhist life. Everybody benefits from that. It's very interesting when you look at Buddhist history. Buddhism is essentially a monastic religion, and it's the monasteries that have carried Buddhism throughout its history. Bhante, of course, has radicalized our perspective on that. But in a way, what he did was say, commitment isn't all about lifestyle. Well, that is what he said. Commitment isn't all about lifestyle. Commitment is primary, lifestyle is secondary. But at the same time, he strongly emphasized the development of these intensive situations for everybody. So people could move in and out of them. People could come in for a short while, go out again. Some people would live all their lives in that sort of way. But I think it's very difficult to maintain depth without some a world, Buddhist worlds, which you can be part of. You know, that does not mean you cannot gain enlightenment without living in those institutions. Did I get the negatives right then? You can gain enlightenment without living in those worlds. But if we really want to communicate the Dhamma much more widely, we need those worlds and institutions, and particularly for young people, where they can train.
That's a homework.
Yeah, you've got a lot. That's only just the beginning, but that'll do. Yeah, I think that is the next phase to me. Is a deeper retreat center life community, which is shared life, right livelihood businesses. Yes, you've got the centers as right livelihood businesses, but we need to be making economic resources available to people. I don't know how easy that's going to be in Mexico, but I think you need to be thinking of the old communities, cooperatives, and right livelihood centers, the three C's as we used to call them, which is slightly out of fashion in the Anglo-Saxon world, sadly. But I think those sort of possibilities need to be brought to life.
Well, I think we're kind of running out of time, so I just want to...
I wanted to ask you something, I'm afraid.
Oh, all right.
Yes, yeah, sure. Would you tell us a little bit about the Toluca Center?
Oh, good.
Yeah, I've only just arrived. I was told it was pequeñito. It's actually a fairly substantial and very handsome center. Yeah, but please tell me the history and so forth. Yeah.
We started as a meditation group.
So these three 17-year-olds or whatever.
Yeah, if you can believe that.
Yeah.
And I must admit that we did have a lot of support from the other members here in Mexico. So I know that you have already rejoiced in Upek Shamati, but I'm going to do that again, because Upek Shamati was one of the other members who were in touch with us and who was supporting us over and over again. The whole thing started as a meditation group, and it kept on functioning as a meditation group for many years. While we were training for ordination as well.
And doing your education, presumably.
Yeah. I did go to university and all that. That's supposed to happen. We as well would invite people to come to Toluca, order members to give talks. And
can you just explain to people where Toluca is? I only know that we went west.
Okay, yeah.
And over the mountains.
I think that's all you need to know. So we're about, I think it's around, it's like 60 kilometers, about 60 kilometers from Mexico City. Mm-hmm. So that's in the center of the country. Mm-hmm. And actually, this I really like living here because it's very convenient. Mm. It's very easy to just go to Mexico City or to move around from the country because we're right in the middle of it. Mm. So we would go to Mexico City. It takes about an hour or an hour and a half. Mm-hmm. And there's where we would be training ourselves with the Mexico City Buddhist Center Sangha. Mm-hmm. And we would invite people to come and give talks. Mm. And yeah, we were very much in touch with them, with other members. And they had a lot of faith in us. Now that I think about it, I think that's weird.
Yeah.
But in a very positive sense, I
it's
am
justified,
really...
isn't it? Here you are.
Yeah.
Their faith in you is justified. Yeah.
So after I got ordained, we decided that I just wanted to dedicate my life fully to the Dharma.
When were you ordained?
I was ordained in 2017. And just a couple of years later, maybe I decided that I wanted to just do that with my time. Mm. So just dedicate my time to the center, but also to the order. Mm. So it's not just the center. Mm. I do give all of my time to the center and the order as well.
You're in the ordination team, I believe.
Yes, yes, I am. And so we found this place, which it was very nice because there was one friend from the Sangha who had a friend who owned this place. So they rented this place for us very cheaply compared to the prices around. Mm. And yeah, I resigned my job in July and then on June and then on July, this was here.
So you work for the center?
Yeah, I do. Huh. I work for the center. And of course we had a lot of friends who already were close to the community. Some of them are here. You cannot see them, but they are here in the audience. Who were, you know, putting the shelves and painting and putting these curtains. So it was not, this definitely was not me. This definitely was not Richard Amati. This was, this is the result of years of friendship. That's what I can say. The project started with friendship and all of this is the result of friendship.
That's wonderful.
Of friendship. Yeah. And so we've been open since 2019. Now, there was a pandemic, very fastly it started, but here we are, luckily. We do have all of our activities online and as well in person now. And yeah, we do have like almost 18 mitras.
18?
Yes.
1-8, yeah.
Yeah, and I just think that it's a very alive, vibrant Sangha at the moment. I'm so happy with it actually, because it's based on friendship.
Yeah,
and that's what you can see when you come. That.
Do you have plans? Because somebody told me that you had 50 people in this hall, which is hard to believe. What are your plans? Are you going to expand? Are you going to take over the dance hall next door?
I would love to do that. Yes, we do have plans. Hopefully in the next 5 years we can move. This place has received us so well, this building. But yeah, it's starting to feel a little short. And also, we don't want it to be a huge center, but just enough.
Okay.
Enough for the people who are coming now, for more people as well, of course, but to keep having this sense of community, friendship, especially the main objective now is to deepen relationships, deepen deepen friendship and to deepen everyone's own practice.
So that's
plan. Maybe even buy something.
Oh, yes.
Now that it is still possible.
Yeah.
So let's see.
And Toluca, what's the size of Toluca? What's the population?
I don't know. Does anyone here know the size of
Media?
I looked it up. I was a leading question. It's 2.4 million. Yeah, the greater Toluca. Yeah, that's a lot of people.
Yeah,
you've got a lot of work to do, haven't you?
We do.
In fact, Toluca can have several centers. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Something you said which really interested me was that Bhakshamati and the order members in the Mexico Buddhist Center put a lot of faith in you.
Yeah.
That really struck me. That as young mitras, they trusted you to do things. And that's probably a bit of a key to the future, isn't it? Particularly young people, I think, need to take initiative quite soon.
Yeah.
So I hope that precedent will be copied.
Yeah.
I wonder if there's any other reflections you've got on that period, because very, very striking that the three of you, came from Toluca together. You exported Sanghadhara.
Yeah.
To benefit the English, of course, yeah. But what was the magic that enabled the Bhakshamati and the others to have confidence in you, do you think?
I think one of the key factors was that we were really trying to keep in touch. So I would have a very strong relationship with Sadayoti, for example, and other order members. And I kept just telling her and them what was happening and what we were doing.
Okay.
And of course, I would be very serious about my personal practice as well. So I would study and I would try to be really present in the Sangha.
Yeah.
So people knew who I was. And the same goes with Ruchi Ramadi.
So it's this combination of, on your part, being open to Kalyanamitratari guidance, and on their part, giving you initiative, having the faith that you would take initiative in dialogue with them.
Yes.
That's an important learning, isn't it? Because I've seen the same at the London Buddhist Center, for instance, with the young people's group, that they're given quite a bit of initiative, but they want to be in dialogue with Kalyanamitras. So perhaps that's sort of a model that needs to be paid attention to. But it is outstanding to me to come here to see what you have created. Yes, Ruchi Ramadi. really outstanding. So it's just the two order members, you know, living here.
Living here, yes.
But you have Nityamani and Carmen, and who else is in sort of on your council?
So it's Nityamani, Satyabodhi, Carmen, and of course Nagapriya has really, really helped us as well. So I really do need to say that, because since he started to be more in touch with Ruchi Ramadi, he was also very interested in helping and supporting Toluca as well, before the Buddhist Center became formally a Buddhist Center, and he is the president of our center as well. So yeah, he was very in touch with me, with Ruchi Ramadi as well, and with the whole project.
Well, I really want to rejoice in your merits and to popularize, advertise what's happened in Toluca, because I think it's a real example of what could happen everywhere, maybe in Argentina and elsewhere. This very important relationship of Kalyanamitrata, where especially young people are empowered to take initiative, but in a clear dialogue with Kalyanamitras, where there's a very friendly, an open relationship both ways. It's outstanding what you've achieved. And I think If you're not already, you should be very, very proud of it. Mm-hmm. And I'm boasting on your behalf to the millions of people who are watching this, are boasting about this center.
Thank you.
Yeah,
I think the important part is that we can recognize Triratna, right? Wherever we go, we can see that it's Triratna.
Yes. As I say, one of the things that I found most refreshing is that in Mexico, I've encountered Triratna as I know it. Because sometimes I feel not completely sure that I understand whether this is or isn't. But in Mexico, it's absolutely unambiguous. It's traditional Triratna as Bante intended it. And he knew that. He gave Upakshamati a lot of confidence. And it's particularly pleasing to me because it works. You don't have to fiddle around with this and that. It works if you just do it properly. And I think the whole movement in Mexico is a living example of that.
Thank you very, very much, Subhuti, for being here with us. It's it's a delight. I love the word. More personally speaking, it does mean a lot that you consider it important to be here and to have this interview here. It has a special value personally and also in Mexico.
Yeah. Well, Upakshamati asked me to come, he says, 28 years ago. But my life has been very, very busy. But I took this opportunity to come. And first of all, Toluca wasn't on the plans because people were concerned about my energy and my health.
Yeah.
But I would have walked to Toluca if I had to, and especially after meeting you two, and feel a very deep connection with you both, and therefore with your center.
Thank you very much, and thank you very much to everyone who has joined us in this talk. It does mean a lot also speaking from Mexico to just be more visible outside and know that we are really looking forward to make more connections internationally and you know, Triratna is about friendship, so we're just looking forward to make friends outside.
Very good. Thank you. Thank you very much to the Buddhist Center Online and David and everybody else.
Gracias por la canción.
Sangadara, hola Sangadara, ¿cómo estás?
Hola.
Hola. Carmen, ¿cómo estás, Madira? Baby. Honey.
Hola,
Madira, Madira, Napa.